Okay, so the topic is on waste management, and I just wanted to begin with a very, okay, it's not a very amusing story, it has a hint of dark humor, but a colleague of mine recently went to meet a startup founder of a waste management company in Gujarat, and he was telling him how the situation was 3 or 4 years ago. Apparently, when they would go up to people's houses and ask them for their waste, the people were a bit suspicious. You know, I mean, okay, if you're going to make something, some money out of this, I mean, what's in it for me? So they were reluctant to actually give their waste to these guys, right? So that's something he would anyway have kind of dumped away. He was reluctant to share just because he thought he could profit from it, right? So I'm sure things have changed since then, and probably we'll start with that. And Bharti, you could probably tell us, I mean, what are the levels of awareness on waste management? I mean, do people see the benefits of it and the dangers of not managing your waste in an efficient manner?
So, first of all, thank you, Francesca. That movie was phenomenal, the little that we saw of it, about 40 seconds of it. But I think people understand that something has to be done. But I think our limitation is that we really believe in a kind of a beautification of our landscapes rather than a sustainable way of taking away materials that will harm them in different ways. And I think that is really our crisis. Our crisis is one of understanding the medium-term problems and challenges and the ecological crisis that something like plastics is... got in India. We have salt which has plastics from Orissa. I mean, birds are found with plastics, so but people don't get it. So you probably all find this really clean, but there's been events before this that have had a lot of plastic that have landed in landfills. We work in landfills. We work with a whole bunch of children who used to be waste pickers. We work with 2,300 children, mostly girls, get them to go to school, and so on and so forth. And those are the people impacted by the plastics. And we don't see that. And I think that's the problem. We're short-sighted, we're blind-sighted, and we don't understand the importance of equity, of involving society, of people way poorer than us when we think of what we should do with waste.
So Yogesh, maybe you could take that forward and probably... shed some light on what we can do to create more awareness.
As compared to what we're talking in India, in Finland, for example, or any of the Nordic countries, you can just drink the water from the rivers or the lakes and just compare it to India. Or, if you talk about another extreme, there's a village called Kamikatsu in Japan where about, we were talking about the waste of our houses being categorized into two categories, recyclable and not recyclable, and black bags and green bags. They do it in 34 categories. Can you imagine? And 80 to 90% of their waste in this village is recycled. And their target to take the recycling level is to 100% by 2020. So these are some of the very, startling numbers. And we have to cover a long way. Of course, the direction is right. But, of course, a journey is long.
So I want to add to it, if I may. And I want to remind all of us here, since we live in India or we are here for some time, is that we have this phenomenal free service of hundreds of men and women, our kabadiwalas, who are recycling up to well over 60% of our waste, whether it's even a safety pin, it gets recycled. And what is really tragic is that I don't think many of us have gone out there and thanked them and said, thank you for what you're doing. You're not taking any money from us. And you know how much money they save just in Delhi alone? They save us a couple of crores every single day because they do us free labor. They segregate our waste because we're lazy and we're incompetent and we couldn't give a damn. These are people who are really building blocks of our country. And so when we talk about how other people recycle, I urge us all to take a moment out and think about these people and show them our gratitude. The next time somebody comes and picks up your waste, please go and at least say thank you.
Sure. I'll come back to the waste pickers and the kabadiwalas later about the empowerment. But before that, I just want to know how much progress have we really made from the, you know, lifting and shifting phenomenon to actually finding really definite means of dealing with our garbage, our waste.
You know, the numbers again, you know, I'll give you some numbers. The world population is currently around 7 billion. It's likely to go up to 10 billion by maybe around another 20, 30 years, by FY 2050. The middle class by that time will be around 50% of this. You know, they'll have their requirements of material and white goods and cars and houses and of course material. You know, it's expected that 5 to 6 billion material will be required. Out of that, 3 billion is going to be waste management. So this is actually huge numbers. You know, to what is most important is reverse logistics. Reverse logistics is basically, you know, for the products, we have forward logistics. We have distributors and warehouses and dealers, and the product goes to the market. Here for waste, it is reverse logistics. Like she said, the rag picker. It starts with that. Of course, in our countries, it starts with the rag pickers. In other countries, there might be mechanized solutions for it. So this is the challenge. To set up reverse supply chains, reverse logistics is a very big challenge. We'll have to, you know, invest in it. You know, it cannot always be manual. Of course, the manual, you know, the way it is starting, we have to be indebted to them. They are doing a yeoman service. It's unfortunate that they are not in the social fabric of the country and all that. So it's fine. But we'll have to also focus on mechanization, automation, and, you know, all these years we've invested in forward logistics. You know, all the warehouses, the cold storages, everything is for forward logistics. There's nothing for, no infrastructure practically, and it's left to that, you know, poor man to do that reverse logistics. So a lot of reverse logistics will have to be, investments will have to be there.
So I believe that what we really need to think about, and you talk about awareness, I think we really have to reduce waste. I don't believe that there is a way out. We cannot go on and on and on and on consuming at the rate that we do. I mean, we cannot. And I think the lead is to be taken by people like us in this lawn this evening, because there is no solution but to reduce. I mean, we are 7.8 million going on 10, I mean, billion going on 10 billion cannot be supported by this planet. I mean, you don't need a new tie every time, and you definitely can have less things. And for that, I think we have to collectively, because there are lots of people who are here who I'm pretty convinced are people who influence, influencers, people who are bosses of other people, people who lay the rules. And so I think it's up to us to change the name or to change the game and to get this paradigm shift that it's all right to wear the same things. It's all right to have less. And I think if we don't do that and if we don't reduce our consumption, which has to be done both in terms of mindsets and social norms, but also create incentives through better policy than we have currently, through state green procurement and a whole bunch of other stuff. But I think I don't see any other solution. And until we cut down, those seals, those baby chicks are going to have plastics in their bodies, and so will all of us.
Yogesh, I just wanted to come to specifically what Tata Steel is doing in the recycling area. You are building India's first scrap recycling plant. Right? Could you kind of explain to us the significance of having a plant like this and perhaps many more down the line?
Yeah, so rightly said, we are setting up steel recycling business, and the first recycling plant is likely to be commissioned in a couple of months. It is coming up near Delhi at Rohtak. So, you know, what is the thought behind it? Traditionally, steel is made through the blast furnace route. And blast furnace route, while it gives the scale, you know, it is capital heavy, land heavy in the sense it uses a lot of land, power heavy, energy heavy, resource heavy in the sense it uses a lot of, you know, raw materials, you have to do the mining and all that. The gestation period is long, you take long time to set it up, you might be adding carbon footprints. As against this, you know, this route recycles the scrap, steel scrap, which is already, you know, getting generated. scrap comes from, you know, what has gone into consumption around 15, 20 years back. So, you know, depending on how much steel went into the society or in the cars or in the buildings, you know, around 50, 20 years back. So about that time it takes to, you know, come back for recycling. India has a reasonable amount of scrap, but there's some countries which progressed much earlier, and, you know, hence they have much greater. So you'll hear that the US, the Europe, China, you know, they all have a lot of scrap, you know, to recycle, and in fact they export to some of our countries. And now, so since India is now having reasonable amount of scrap, it was thought that, you know, with sustainability point of view for the future, we should be investing or seeding into this from a slightly long term perspective, because of the sustainable development goals in mind and the other benefits that I talked about, you know, lesser energy, lesser capex, and these are modular units. You know, they typically are set up near the urban clusters, for example near Delhi, where there will be a lot of scrap available. Scrap comes from households, industries, end of life vehicles. So this scrap is taken by such companies like ours. It will be processed, it will be recycled, and steel will be made out of it again. So this is what we are setting up.
Okay, I want to come to the social benefits of, the social trickle down of such waste management efforts. And one of them is clearly the Safai Sena that Chintan has created, right? Where you don't have scavengers, but you have managers, right? So could you tell us something more about that?
So the way that we imagine the world of consumption is that it's got to be, waste is a great tool to fight poverty. We have more people who are poor in our country here in India than sub-Saharan Africa. Much as it's hard to believe, this is our truth. We've got many more people out of poverty, but we're not quite there. So there are really three ways that we go about it. Firstly, we don't want kids to be picking trash. And so we've been working with children, getting them to go to school, making sure they stay there. Most of those kids are girls, so they shouldn't be getting married at the age of 15. So that stuff. We work with, currently our batch is 2,300 kids in the NCR. But then there's the other point about livelihoods. And what we do is provide fabulous, fabulous, if I may say so myself, waste management services. So the Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, IIT Delhi, we've made them a zero waste community. We dump less than 20 tons of waste in the landfill and we almost compost everything. We recycle almost everything. We create jobs. We've done that even with this hotel. I mean, we just lost our contract, but because, as you all know, the prices of plastic and paper crashed. But so we lost the contract in this hotel. But for 14 years, a group of old women were recycling every last scrap and composting the waste of this hotel as well. So we work with e-waste. We have a solution called Pick My Trash. You can download the app or you can call us. And two young men who are from waste picking families, one of whom used to go door to door when he was 8 years old and pick up trash in East Delhi. The two of them run it, we incubate it, and essentially they'll come to your house and they'll pick up your waste, and they will tell you where it's recycled, who the recycler is, and we make those linkages as well. So that part of the livelihood, which is quite innovative, whether we look at recycling, composting, making zero waste, we go to a whole bunch of offices, that part is scavengers to managers. And the difference between what somebody does on the road and what we do is that we are looking at giving skills and talents to the poor so that they make the money and then they can invest in their future. And how it works for Chintan is we raise money so that we can get a proper supervisor, so that we can get Salesforce licenses and get the data there. And that's it sounds really simple, but it's a very empowering model. So we have a few, almost 3,000 jobs that we've created, and you'll see in the next 2 years, you'll see that double.
Wow, that's something. Yeah. Yogesh, you too have an opportunity to empower the waste pickers, right? The scrap dealers who right now are fairly fragmented and unorganized. So this is an opportunity for Tata to actually do some good at that level.
Yeah, so that is in the radar. You know, we had done a similar thing for our forward supply chain, for our products, you know, when we have our dealers. So, you know, we went up right up to the masons, the mistries, the guys who, you know, actually make the house, people who work with them, the welders. And we had some programs to uplift their status. You know, they were the poor people who were not in the social fabric. And we ran some programs, loyalty programs, you know, for gifting them, awarding them, and also uplifting their skills. Likewise, for this part of the business, the steel recycling business, the reverse supply chain, as we said, it starts with the rag picker, the person who starts. So it is our vision that, you know, ultimately we'll reach up to that place, you know. So what picture exactly, I'll try to paint a picture, which may take some time to come, but definitely, you know, just imagine the rag picker who's coming to a house, you know, people don't trust him too much and all that. But imagine a guy, you know, having a uniform, maybe or maybe not, some badge, you know, of maybe the Tatas or some company, having an electronic weigh scale, you know, so that people don't, you know, worry about, you know, whether he's cheating or not. He's got the price list with him, you know, for what is that, you know, because people often doubt whether the price is right or not. You know, imagine that scenario and from what it is now. This person has, you know, some medical benefits, some provident fund, some status in the society. So that is what our vision is. Of course, you know, that we've just started the journey. So to reach that place, you know, it will take some time, but that is what it is thought.
So I'm going to link Safai Sena. It has over 15,000 members. And I'm going to give them your card that you gave me earlier today. And I hope that you both will have a great partnership.
Yes, sure, sure.
Okay, Bharati, I want to ask you a very specific question, a bit hypothetical. But let's say you meet a CEO, even maybe later this evening, and he tells you, of course, I recognize the importance of sustainability, but it's not my immediate priority. What would you do to change his mind?
Well, actually, it's not that theoretical. I meet quite a few CEOs who are like, oh, you poor little NGO, sweet little things, so satisfying. But you know, guess what? My life is bigger than the environment. So I meet them all the time. But my point is that, I don't know, we're all sitting out here today, but the air is unhealthy, and we know that. And earlier today, I was in Banaras, where the air was actually hazardous, twice as bad as Delhi, and Delhi is very bad today. So my point is that 1 lakh Indians every single month fall down dead because of air pollution. 83 people every day in Delhi, which is pretty much the three of us and half this lawn. So if you're not, if this is the state of our bodies, if this is your workforce, how on earth are you going to get the brains and the muscle to take forth the strategic work, the minds and the people? You don't have a workforce. Air pollution, for example, is not just about our lungs. Talking of lungs, one half of Delhi's children have irreversible lung damage. One half, okay? But more than that, it's affecting our minds. There's ample evidence that diabetes and memory, and quite young in life, people have huge mental health issues because of the impact of air pollution. This is science out in 2019. So my point is that it isn't just about an abstract planet, if that's what people want to believe. It's about us. It's about equally about your bottom line, because nobody's going to be there to run your work, to run your business plans. There'll be nobody there after you. You won't have a successor. And it's no point building a brand. It's no point building a brand which is going to be run by people whose brains are impacted and whose bodies are impacted by pollution. I don't know how many of you know that 40,000 birds died in the last 10 days in Rajasthan's Sambar Lake. I mean, we're living in a planetary emergency, in a climate crisis. Out of the blue, this bacteria popped up and we had 40,000 birds just dropping like this and dying. We're living in an emergency, and I think CEOs are very, very important leaders to help us find solutions and to support those solutions and to normalize new ways of living instead of normalizing and emphasizing ways of living that have proved themselves to be our nemesis.
Yogesh, during times when the economic growth slows down, does sustainability go to the back burner? Is the next quarter's profit perhaps more important?
Not for our company. You know, I'm not bragging about Tata's, as we all know, they have been initiated into sustainability and CSR quite long. So it doesn't. And secondly, it is not as if, you know, it is modular. We've got systems and processes so that, you know, once it is done, it goes on. It doesn't, you know, there's no switch on and switch off. But definitely, you know, I would urge more and more corporates and more companies, of course, there might be many more doing it, to have that systems and processes for sustainability rather than being, a bad month, so put it off. You know, we'll put it up in better times or something like that. And you asked about, you know, the message for CEOs. I would imagine it is, you know, leave the world a better place than what you inherited. You know, if that, you know, that is the one line for sustainability. You know, you'll find many definitions. I found it the simplest. Leave it a better place than what you inherited. And in fact, you know, once this panel discussion is over, and if someone, if your music system has it, you can play that song, "We Are the World, We Are the Children." So that is a brighter day. Maybe we can understand it as a better day, a better place, you know, and you can play that song.